I'm in love. God is good. He came to us all the time and all the time. God is good. I always forget that part. Don't forget that part. God came to us and God has forgiven us. God has saved us. And now we have the opportunity of not just coming to Him, but living for Him. God, give us clean hands.
Thank you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this church. Thank you for these people. Thank you that we live in a country where we can still gather together in your name. God, help us not take it for granted. God, help us not just do church. Help us truly seek you. Humble ourselves and be willing to change whatever it is in our life that's not honoring to you. God, help us honor you. God, help us want clean hands. Help us want pure hearts. And help us be willing to sacrifice anything in our life that's keeping us from that and keeping us from you. It's in Jesus' precious and powerful name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for coming. Please be seated. You may already know this, but God is the boss. Have you figured that out? He's the boss, El Jefe. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the King of Kings. He's the King over all the other kings. He's the Lord over all the other lords. He is the man. He is the master. He is the majestic one. God is great. But he still wants us to get to him. The Bible says that God is sovereign. He's the boss over everything. But he's sympathetic. He understands us. He gets us. He feels us. I feel you, dog. He feels us better than that. He understands us even better than that. He is a sovereign God, but he's a sympathetic God. The Bible says he's not just there, but he's here. He's not just out there, but if you've given your life to him, he's in here. God is great, but he still wants us to get to him. How hard would it be to get to the governor or to get to President Trump? Kind of hard, do you think?
Do it myself. I know it's not.
We're learning more today about the guy who rushed the stage at a Trump rally in Ohio. 22-year-old Thomas DeMassimo sparked panic when he made a beeline for Trump.
I guess I have to do it myself. I know it's not.
The billionaire was immediately surrounded by his security detail. DeMassimo, who says he was not trying to hurt Trump, was charged with disturbing the peace and inciting a panic.
You try to get to someone like the governor, you try to get to someone like the president. It's kind of difficult, right? I mean, you can come see me anytime, but good luck trying to get close to Pastor Skip or Pastor Smotherman, or it'd be kind of like that, or probably worse, I'm not sure. It's kind of hard to get close to people who are that big, but the Bible says our God is even greater than that, and he still wants you to be able to get to him. That's what Psalm 24 is all about. God really wants you to be able to find him.
Go get him, Isaiah.
Oh, here he is.
Now, it may feel like he's playing hide-and-go-seek with you, but he really wants you to find him. You think if the monkey really wanted to hide, you think he could? I think he could. He's playing that kid like a sock puppet. Wait for you. God really wants you to find him. It may seem sometimes like you can't get to him. It may feel sometimes like you can't find him. But the Bible says even though God is great, God is grand, God is God, he still wants you to get to him. In Psalm 24, the 24th Psalm, page 544, if you're using the Pew Bible, the Blue Bible, but in the 24th Psalm, David poured out his heart This is possibly just a hymn that David wrote to express his experience when he was going up to the temple. It might have been a song that he wrote for people to be able to worship. If any of you grew up Catholic like I did, remember the priest would say something, we'd say something back. The priest would say something, we'd say something. It was a responsive reading. I don't remember. Lord have mercy. I'll have mercy. How do you know this stuff? She's already doing that, and she's already putting a doily on her head, and she knows how to do this thing, yeah. It might have been a responsive reading. It might have been, tradition tells us, that David could have written this song, this psalm, as an expression of the experience he was having when they took back the box of God. Remember the Ark of the Covenant? Not the Ark, Noah's Ark, but the box of God. When they brought it back, it was in some dude's house, I forget all their names. The Philistines had beat up on Israel, and they captured the box of God because they thought it was God. Well, it wasn't. Remember, they put the box of God in the temple of Dagon. The Dagon was the fish god, half man, half fish. And Dagon, the statue, was in the temple. Oh, and they brought the box of God in there, and God was not in the box.
But the Bible says that God doesn't play well with fake gods. And the Bible says that when they came into Dagon's temple the next day, Dagon was flat on his face. The statue was down on the ground. And so they picked their god up and they nailed him to the wall so that Dagon wouldn't fall down. And there is Dagon, their fish god, next to the box of God. And they went out about their business. They came back the next morning. Dagon, the statue, was on his face before God with his hands and head cut off. God doesn't play nice with other gods. He doesn't play fair. You got to be nice with all the other gods. God says, I'll have no other god before me. And he doesn't play fair. Well, they brought the box of God back from the Philistines' place to that dude's house. Uzzah, well-intentioned Uzzah, got killed because, remember, they put the box of God on a cart. They were supposed to carry it on their shoulders. And the cart hit a pothole. It was probably in Albuquerque. It hit a pothole, and the box of God started to fall off, and Uzzah reached out and touched it, and how did God reward him? Killed him right there. It wasn't Uzzah's fault. It was David's fault. David knew how they were supposed to treat the things of God. God was underscoring his holiness, his majesty, his greatness, but for whatever reason, that's what happened. So the box of God stayed there. Can you imagine how the guy felt when David said, we're going to put it in your house? Alamodi. It wasn't bad enough that Uzzah was killed when he touched the box of God. Do you remember what happened? The box of God was in the Philistine camp, and the people in the Philistine camp started getting sick, and they got sick, and they started dying. And some of them, they got so sick that they prayed to their gods, Dagon specifically, what shall we do to get rid of this plague? And so they figured out what we need to do is figure out what the plague is, and we need to make little golden statues to honor the God that's bringing about that plague. And they made golden emeralds. That's in the King James. If you read the NIV and the rest, golden hemorrhoids, a la mode. People were dying because of the hemorrhoids that God had sent into the camp because they were trying to box with the box of God against Dagon. And a lot of those guys were getting really sick and messed up. And so they made these little golden statues of emeralds. Can you imagine? Whose job is it to make golden hemorrhoids for the... But they crank those things out, and they offered them to... God doesn't play nice with all the other gods. But they brought the box of God out of the Philistine camp. They started to take it back to Jerusalem. Uzzah reached out, got killed. They put it in this dude's house, and God blessed. God blessed, and God blessed. And sometime down the road, David said, I guess it's okay. I guess it's cool. And so they brought the box of God back to Jerusalem. Many think that David wrote this psalm as an expression of his joy in bringing the box of God back. For whatever reason, God inspired, he breathed out many psalms, not the least of which is Psalm 24. David wrote the psalm, and David said, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. The earth is the Lord's and everything that's in it. The world and all who live in it belong to God. Verse 2, because God founded the dirt on the waters. He founded the seas and established it on the waters. Verse 3, who may go up to the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in God's holy place? Verse 4, it's the one who has clean hands. It's the one who has a pure heart. It's the one who does not trust in an idol. It's the one who will not swear by a false god. Verse 5, those are the ones who will receive blessing from the Lord. Those are they who will receive vindication from God their Savior. Verse 6, such is the generation of those who seek God, who seek your face, O God of Jacob. Verse 7, so lift up your heads, you gates, be lifted up. They're talking to doors now. They're talking to literal gates, right? This is one of the reasons that many think that this was a responsive reading that David wrote for worshipers as they went to the temple of the Lord. Lift up your heads, you gates, be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. And from the inside of the closed doors, the responsive readers would say, who is the King of glory? And from the outside of the doors, the Lord who is strong and mighty, the Lord who is mighty in battle. Verse 9, lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors. They're repeating the chorus is kind of what you have here. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? This King of glory is the Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory, Psalm 24 reads. Whether it was written as a responsive reading for people coming into the temple, whether it was written as an expression of joy for the box of God coming back, maybe it was just an expression of David's excitement. Whatever it is, God, theonoustos, theos, God, pneumonia, pneumatic, pneuma, wind of God. God breathed out the 24th Psalm through David's heart. And in this psalm, this is what we find. God wants us to know his power. God tells us a lot of things in this short psalm. One of the things he tells us is God wants us to know his power. He starts by telling us of his strength, his power, his majesty in creation. He created you. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded the world on the seas. He established the dirt upon the waters. God created you. He not only created you, but the Bible says he fights for you. Look at verse 7. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong, the Lord mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Now, one of the things I said to the early service is we want to get to the place where we're not just reading these psalms like they're just songs. I was listening to a couple of Christian artists and a secular singer here in the last couple of weeks, and they kind of said the same thing, that when they go to work in the morning and they're talking about writing songs. Another guy talked about, well, it was kind of funny that I couldn't find just the right words to express what I wanted to say because that's my job. I write songs for a living. A lot of us turn on Christian radio, or we throw in a CD or put on your whatever and turn the thing on. And we just, you know, a lot of times we think these songs just came from heaven. Guys went to work. Guys get up in the morning. Maybe they read their Bible a little bit. Maybe they just do like me and turn on Leave It to Beaver, you know. And you know, they love the Lord and they drink their cup of coffee and they go to work. Maybe they go to an office or out their back porch or they go someplace. They read the Bible and they crank out Christian songs. It's like making hamburger, like making sausage. I don't mean to demean it. I'm just saying that most of the stuff we listen to, it didn't come from God any more than my sermons came from God. I don't think that's going to disappoint you. In fact, I don't think it even surprises you. God doesn't give us sermons. I wish he did. If you ever heard a pastor say, and the Lord spoke to my heart today, I'm just going to bring to you what the Lord gave to me. Liar or mistaken. God doesn't give us sermons. If he did, we wouldn't have to do delete all the time and backspace on our computers. We would just open our mouths and then God words would come out. It's not just God words that come out. Sometimes if we're lucky, good words, and sometimes just stupid. Not from me. Yeah, from me. Songs are often just expressions of a guy's heart. Maybe they're just things coming out of a guy's head. When you read the lyrics of a song, when you read the words of a psalm, listen to what it's saying. A lot of the Christian music that we sing is really kind of stupid. It's not theological. It inspires. I mean, it makes us feel, oh, makes us happy, or it makes us all, oh, boy, you know, I'll charge hell with a 3-shot water pistol. Boy, that's a good song for Jesus. I felt the Lord when the band was singing. No, you did not. You got goosebumps, or you like the, that wasn't the Lord. You know, God doesn't come around and touch you and give you Holy Ghost goosebumps and, ooh, that was the Holy Ghost. No, they probably just turn the air conditioner on. It feels good. And I know, I'm not very spiritual, am I? The Holy Spirit is here. He doesn't come here. He's here. God is here. God is omnipresent. God is present. If you don't feel him, oh, well, get right with God. I felt the Lord. Okay, whatever. We get Holy Ghost goosebumps over stupid stuff. Not stupid like sinful, just, you know, at some point, it's okay to be a little kid. I mean, I still believe in Santa as long as he brings me presents. As long as the tooth fairy's leaving money under the pillow, I'm going to keep putting my teeth there. Why not? Yeah. Some things are just, you know, it's just okay. It's just okay. As you get a little older, you start figuring this thing out. Tooth is still there, no money. I'm 25 years old. Tooth is still there, no money. You know, you start thinking things through. When you're reading Bible stories to your kids, your grandkids, they're not just Bible stories. This stuff happened to people. God came to people. God revealed himself to people. People died in his presence. People were changed in his presence. Lives are never the same in his presence. If you're still doing the same junk now you were doing before you prayed the prayer, you know me, I would say you probably didn't get the real thing. Well, who the heck am I to judge? I'm the one who's reading the Bible. Glory! You can read it too. And the Bible says that when you come to Jesus, the Holy Spirit is going to start making you more like Jesus. And if you're not becoming more like Jesus, if you're spending all your time distracted by junk in the world, no. Don't fool yourself. Go back and make sure you're right with God. Now, I said all that to say this. What the monkey does it mean? God is in battle. God. What kind of battle is God in? I don't even get the story where Michael the archangel was fighting the prince of Persia. The prince of Persia was a demon over Iran, Iraq in the day of Daniel. Why would Michael the archangel have to fight, do battle? What does that mean? The Bible says that angels are incorporeal. They don't have, I ain't got no body. They don't have a body. They don't have hands and feet. Now, sometimes they appeared, right? But they're spirit. Michael the archangel was fighting a demon over Persia. What does that mean? What does that mean? They just called each other names? Jesus freak. Gunky. What? Did they fight each other? We read this stuff, we just, hallelujah, oh, praise the Lord, they're just fighting. What does it mean? What does it mean that God does battle? I have no idea. How did God create? Well, like the rest of us, he goes to Home Depot and Lowe's, and he throws junk in the back of his truck, and he shows up with a hammer and a saw. Is that how God made the world? No. What does the Bible say? He spoke it into existence. How did God make the light? He turned it on. God spoke. How does God fight? Well, he's gotta bulk up. Gotta bulk up. Gotta go into training. Gotta bulk up. How does God fight? God doesn't have to fight. Maybe Satan is very, very strong. He is very, very strong. But compared to God, he's very, very nothing. What does it mean he does battle? You know my answer? If you've been here long enough, what's my answer? I don't know. But I do know this. I know that the Bible says that if you've given your life to Jesus Christ, if you haven't, then you can do whatever you want for the next couple of minutes. But if you've given your life to Jesus, listen, he has promised to preserve you. He's promised to protect you. He's promised to position you in such a way that when the world is saying, come on and have fun with us, come and do what we do. Come and do what we do. Come and do what we do. Don't be like them, be like us. When the world is calling, when the flesh is saying, I want the 24th taco, I should stop at 23. When the flesh says, I want, when the world says, you can have, when Satan says, no, this way is better than that way, I don't understand why, but God lets you choose. God lets you vote. And here you is, and here's the world. And here's the flesh, and here's the devil. Satan can't stop you, but he can throw up enough doubt, discouragement. You get disillusioned, and who decides to quit? I decide to quit. You can't make me quit. I know you've tried. No, you haven't tried. I make me quit. Not just every Monday morning quit. I mean, what am I doing? For reals, this is pastoral depression. Why are we doing this? People are just going to get torqued anyway. They're not going to change anyway. They're going to come in and they're going to leave the same way anyway. And so we wonder, why am I wasting their time? And if the pity party really gets real, then we don't worry about why am I wasting their time. We think more, why am I wasting my time? I never get there because I'm too spiritual. But we don't want to waste anybody's time. The flesh makes freaky deaky sense. What difference is it going to make? We say to ourselves. The world says, come on, you can love Jesus and still have fun. The world says, you don't have to quit everything. The world says, come on. The flesh says, go ahead on. The devil says, it's better over here than there. I don't know what it means that God fights for you, except that the Bible does promise he'll preserve you, he'll protect you, and he'll position you so that the world, the flesh, and the devil will not overwhelm you, will not overtake you, will not beat you if you vote this way. What a stupid system. If I were God, I didn't mean to call you stupid, but why? If I were God, I just would have made a bunch of Jesus robots or something. I wouldn't give us choice. Now, don't get hung up on free will. Free will is self-will, and self-will is sin. So don't get hung up, well, we've got free will. Yeah, sinner. So don't get hung up on free will. Here you are. Here's the world. Here's the flesh. Here's the devil. Here's God. You get to choose. If you choose the world, God will let you go. If you choose the flesh, God will let you do it. If you choose Satan, God will let you go. Were you ever really saved? Mm-hmm. I'm pretty judgmental because the Bible says to judge with righteous judgment. I don't think there is such a thing as a carnal Christian. I don't think there is such a thing as a person who comes to Jesus and then lives for themselves. A person who comes to Jesus and then lives like the devil. I don't think there is such a thing. If you come to Jesus, the Bible says the Holy Spirit is going to pull you in His direction so that if you come to Jesus, you will be becoming more like Jesus. That's great theology, poor grammar, but that's good theology. If you come to Jesus, you will be becoming more and more and more and more like Jesus. That means that when the world and the flesh and the devil say, come on, you're going to get stronger in saying no thank you or no. Like that, to the world, the flesh, and the devil. Because you get it all, don't get cocky, but there should be a confidence. He will fight for you. I don't know what that means. But when the world says come, when the flesh says do, when Satan says it's okay, and God is saying follow me, you vote. How will you vote? He promised to fight for you. Now, some battles can get pretty brutal. Some battles can get pretty bloody. I don't know what you're experiencing right now. Some of you might want to turn away.
She's a mom, just a mom.
I can't.
I don't know if she's an actor. She...
Most battles don't turn out like that, do they? Some battles can turn out pretty brutal. Some battles can be very bloody. Most of your spiritual battles are not going to turn out like that. It's a real fight with the world, the flesh, and the devil, and you. God's not fighting the world. God's not fighting the flesh. God's not fighting the devil. You are, or you're not. If you're not, are you really saved? Who the heck am I to ask a question like that? I'm the guy who's given his life to try to help you come to Jesus. I'm the guy who's given his life to try to help you become more like Jesus. That's who I am. And I don't want to waste your time. And I sure don't want to waste mine. And I sure don't want to waste God's. Because every dollar in my pocket, every dollar we've invested, every minute we've spent on you, every minute we've spent on ministry is either going to bring glory to God or is going to be wasted. And my ministry is going to go through the fire of God. And it'll burn up like wood or hay and stubble. That's a good-looking house, but that fire took it out like that. But if my ministry is gold, silver, and precious stones, it'll go through the fire, will come out refined, and God will say, hey, come here, high fives. Probably I'm going to see it all go up chamusca. I don't know. Because I don't know what's going on in your hearts. I only know what I see. I only know how you make your decisions. I only know how you decide to make your world, flesh, and the devil fight. I know what God wants. Deny yourself. Don't give yourself everything self wants. Don't do what the world does. Don't do what Satan wants you to do. I know his vote. What's yours? Some battles can get pretty brutal. If you don't experience the fight, spiritual fight. If you don't feel like you're fighting the world, if you're not fighting the flesh, if you're not fighting the devil, you might be going in the wrong direction. For reals. Because if you're standing with Jesus, you're going to feel the fight. You can't love Jesus and love the world. Jesus said, if you love the world, you hate God. Most of us here would not say we hate God, and most of us still play in the world. I'm not sure what all these are. they meant something in my head, but once I did them, I thought, that's just wasted energy. Now I have to breathe. If you're not fighting the world,
If you're not fighting the flesh, if you're not fighting the spiritual battle, you're moving in the wrong direction. Some battles can get pretty brutal. He created you. You belong to Him. He fights for you. Stand with Him. Why would we stand on the wrong side of the fight? And He's waiting for you. Verse 9 is not specifically saying that God is waiting for you any more than verse 7 and 8 are specifically saying He's fighting for you. But there's a principle here. Look at verse 9. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up. Gates don't have heads. Do your fence gates have heads? Unless you paint it on, kind of. But it's an anthropomorphism where you ascribe human characteristics or human attributes to an inanimate object. Anthropomorphism. Did I say that right? Sounds like a sneeze. Did I say it right? Gates, lift up your heads. Lift your head up, ancient door. It looks like this is a moving into the temple area. The temple is surrounded by a temple wall, right? You saw President Trump. You saw Melania. You've seen other people. You've seen President Obama go to the Wailing Wall in Israel. You've seen videos in the news. And they go up to the Wailing Wall, and they put their hand on it, and they write a prayer, and they fold it up, and they tuck it in the little cracks in the part of the temple, part of the temple wall, part of the temple mount, part of the temple fence, I don't know. But this seems to be referring to the wall around the temple. And from the outside, open the doors. And from the inside, why should we? Outside, because we got a really special guy out here. From the inside, who's so special that we should open the doors? From the outside, He's mighty. He's filled with glory. From the inside, Ossi, who is it? From the outside, it's the Lord Almighty. It's the King of glory. That's what this is. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is He, this King of glory? He's the Lord Almighty. He's the King of glory. Now, this passage doesn't specifically say He's waiting for you. But you've seen the picture of Jesus standing at the door. There's a handle on the inside, not a handle on the outside. And you know, the passage is referring to the painting is referring to the passage in Revelation, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man open the door, I will come in and sup with him. I'll fellowship with him. And right, I'll be with him. He'll be with me." The Bible says that God wants you to come close to Him. The Bible says that Jesus wants you to follow Him. When you come to Jesus for reals, not just pray a prayer, not just get religious, not just turn over a new leaf, when you realize that you're at the end of your spiritual rope. I was there when I was 18, and I wasn't a bad kid. Well, no, I wasn't that bad. I was a normal 18-year-old kid, and I'd never done any of the big sins. I don't know what those are. Those are the ones that the other guys have done that you haven't yet, right? But I was an okay kid. But I had spent so much time listening to Carl tell me God stuff, I was convinced that I was on my way to hell. Not because of what Carl said, but I knew now that the Bible said that I was a sinner. The Bible says that any good works that I had was like a pile of filthy rags. The Bible says that Jesus Christ, the God of heaven, became a man. He came, He lived, He died, was buried, rose from the dead so that my sins could be forgiven. I didn't think my sins were that bad, but if they were bad enough to bring Him here, to put Him there, they must be pretty bad. He rose from the dead to prove that He could make good on every promise, including the one He would forgive me and redeem me and save me and change me. At some point in that 8 months of listening to Carl, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, at some point, I wasn't just saying no to Carl anymore. At some point, I wasn't just ignoring my buddy anymore. At some point, I wasn't just turning off conversation or a sermon. At some point, I believed, this is God's word. I am a sinner. Jesus is God. He died for my sins, was buried, rose from the dead. Tony, what are you going to do about it? And on the inside, I was broken. I wasn't that bad a person. But if the Bible was true, I was a pretty bad guy. Not good bad, bad bad. And I needed Jesus. I was convinced that if I didn't give my life to Jesus, I would die and go to hell. It wasn't just fire insurance. The Bible says, I'm far away from him, and I wanted to be close to him. And so I prayed the prayer. I gave up. I could have just as well said, Jesus, I give up. You know, it almost doesn't matter what the words were. I give up. I didn't need Peter in the Bible to tell me, but Peter expressed it well, that when I gave my life to Jesus, I was purchased. I was bought with a price. Paul said in Ephesians, Peter said it in his book, in his gospel, I don't belong to me anymore. So why do I keep living like it's my mouth? Why do I keep living like it's my time? Why do I keep living like it's my money? Why do I let everything pull me away? I've got good soil and good seed, and it goes into the ground and it starts to grow up, and I let the cares of the world choke out the spiritual life that's in me. Why do I let that happen over and over and over and over? I have a heavenly Father who not only created me and is fighting for me, he's waiting for me to say, please come in. I've already been saved, but please come into my life again. Please come into my life again. Please come into my life today. I've got to make this decision. Please come into my life. Please, please help me make this decision in a way that will make you happy, God. Not in a way that will make me happy. Not in a way that will make me successful. Not in a way that will make me satisfied, but in a way that will make you happy and you satisfied. That's a tough one, because the flesh is saying, you know what's best for you. And you get to vote. And he's waiting. He created you. He's fighting for you. But he's waiting. How are you going to vote? God wants you to come to his place. He really does. He refers in verse 3 to his peak and his presence. He says, who may ascend to the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The mountain of the Lord, he's referring to a literal peak. He's referring to Mount Zion. Okay. His presence, it looks like he's talking about Mount Moriah, where the temple was built, where Abraham was going to sacrifice his son Isaac. Come into his place. Today that would be, yeah. But more important than coming to church, because most of us don't think it's that important, I'm not just preaching to the choir, tell the guys who aren't here, I am talking to you because you're here. Most of us don't get it. Most of us don't realize. If I've done one thing really well, I've communicated to people there's nothing magic about coming into this building. Why is that the one I did such a good job in communicating? There's nothing magic about coming here. And doggone, most people don't feel that when they miss. Some of you do. Some of you do. Some of you do. I know you do. You make it clear. You don't say, oh, I missed it. I mean, it's not that. I can tell when you miss it. I can tell when you're happy to be here. I can tell when you've already bought into the lie that it doesn't matter. I can tell. I can tell. You can tell. Everybody can tell. Everybody can tell. That doesn't matter now. Here we are. Come to the peak. Come into his presence. Come to Mount Zion. Come to Mount Moriah. Now is the time. Now is the accepted time. Don't ignore his voice, as many have done. Now is the day of salvation. Now is the time. Doesn't matter what you did yesterday. What are you going to do from here, you sorry son of a gun? I added that last part. That's the problem. We're sinners. We're selfish. We're self-centered. We don't see ourselves that way. We just know we're beat up by the world. And you are. And you're beat up by the flesh. I can tell. Half of you smell like Ben Gay, just like me. Yeah, I know. You're hurting, man. I know. It's okay. And Satan, you don't have to tell me. I know what Satan's doing to you. I know what Satan wants to do to you. And the more you let the world and this garbage distract you, the harder it's going to be for you to vote, I want God. I want the God stuff in my life. Because you think you're picking between good and bad. That's why I called you a sorry son of a gun. Because you ought to know better. You're not picking between good and bad. You ought to be picking between good and godly. He created you. He's fighting for you. And he's waiting for you. And we still let everything in the world pull us away. When you come into his presence, how could anything distract us from him? But most of us don't see him. We see the world, and we see the flesh, and we see the devil. We don't see him. How can we not see him? Most of us have an uneasiness a distressed, a disease, a dis-ease. And we try to fill it with doing something fun on the weekend. We try to fill it with, well, it's Friday night. Let's go do something. Hey, let's go to the thing. And there's nothing bad with going to do the thing, whatever the thing is. It's just that anything that pulls you away from Him, anything that feeds the flesh so that you don't feel so diseased, you're feeding the flesh and you're voting the other way. I'm not going to send you to hell. But it reveals what's inside. It reveals what you want. It reveals who you are. God wants us to enjoy His peace. If you don't have a peace, figure out why. Well, you need more drugs. No, that's a joke. This side went like that. Whoa, I got permission. No, you don't need more drugs. Tony said. Yeah, so you go to your doc and you say, oh, I need someone else. I don't know. It's full of anxiety. You know, she said, I know anxiety. I'm not saying, you know, it's imaginary. Ignore it. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that God knows you. And if you're still diseased, it's a spiritual problem, maybe a chemical imbalance. Ask the doc. She knows about that stuff. I'm not the doc. I'm the preacher. Mine's more important than hers. When you get to heaven, you won't need a doctor anymore. Actually, you're not going to need a preacher anymore either, come to think of it. So take advantage of me while you can. If you are still diseased, if you are still distressed, if you're still uneasy, God wants you to enjoy His peace. He says, the one who can come into my presence is the one who has clean hands and the one who has a pure heart. The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. The one who has a pure heart, that's the one who's saved. You have piety on the inside. We don't use words like that, piety. Sounds like something you do with, sounds like something I get to eat. Piety. That's on the inside. When you get saved, you become a saint. You become a Christian. That's a pure heart on the inside. Clean hands on the outside, that's your sanctification. He cleans you from sin on the inside when you get saved. You stay clean on the outside by saying no to the world and the flesh and the devil. God could pull you over there, but He doesn't. I wish He would. I wish He would. I wish He would. That's that free will nonsense. Free will is self-will, and self-will is sin. There. You don't have free will. Well, you have free will just like you have sin. So if you want to live for yourself, knock yourself out. Free will yourself into oblivion. But if you're saved as a saint, that's piety. If you look like it, you're living like it, you keep denying yourself, you keep saying no to the world and the flesh and the devil, you're going to find yourself moving toward purity. That's sanctification. Who gets to come into the presence of the Lord? Pure heart, clean hands. If you're still diseased, if you're still distressed, if you're still filled with anxiety, I'm not saying there's not a chemical thing that maybe needs to be helped along. Our bodies are broken. I get it. Our bodies are broken. But don't start with more drugs. Start with more Jesus. I know that sounds pretty simple, but it comes from a higher authority than a doctor or a preacher. Come close to God. Run from the devil. Flee from the devil. Run to God. Humble yourself. God will lift you in due time. You want that purity. You want that piety. That's how you get the peace of God. Most of us don't believe that we are dirty dog sinners, but you are. That's fun calling you that. You know what? That's us. Man, we're just doing our thing. It's my nature. Oh, busted.
What are you doing?
Nothing.
Aren't you doing anything?
Nothing.
You're right.
We covered up. Nobody knows what we've done.
I see ya.
God sees us. Dirty dog sinner. But they're not big sins. It's just little, you know? Any big old lie. I just said, tell him I'm not home. My dad says to tell you he's not home right now. Why didn't you lie right? You're not not big old sins, usually little sins. We get so full of self, man. We get so full of anger because he did that to me. He talked to me like that. He treated me like that. It doesn't matter what it looks like on the outside. On the inside, we are just dirty dog sinners. God wants us to know his peace. We're sinners, and it's not in our nature to want to get cleaned up. If you've not come to Jesus, you don't want to get
saved.
You don't want to get clean. You don't want to be without sin.
It's okay. Come on. No.
Oh, that's the cat saying no.
No.
Now that makes sense, right?
No.
Pobrecito, little cat.
Killing him.
We're sinners. Some of us won't want to get cleaned up. I don't want to be like you guys, I used to say. Actually, I used to say I don't want to be like you Baptists, because that's what I used to say to Carl. And I didn't. I didn't want to be like them. Now that I know a few, I still don't want to be like you, even though I'm a Baptist preacher, right? But I do want to be like Jesus. How am I going to know what it's like to be like Jesus? I can read the Bible, but I watch you. I do. I watch you. And where you're doing better than I am, I copy you. And where you're doing worse than I am, I preach about you. I gossip about you. I dog you. We are sinners. And by nature, we don't want to get cleaned up. But some of us are going to get it. Some of us are going to get sick. I don't mean some of you are going to get it. I mean some of us are going to snap. And we're going to say, wow, I don't have to live like this. I've given my life to Jesus. He really wants more of my life. How much more can I give him? You just keep giving. You just keep giving. At some point, we're going to realize that to get close to God, you got to be clean. I know it doesn't seem natural. Sinners don't want to get clean. Sinners like sin. Sinners like doing what they want to do. Sinners go wherever the heck they want to go. Sinners do whatever they want to do. Saints, people who vote God's side, they want to be like Jesus. And Jesus doesn't have sin. So who do you want to be like? People in the world? People who follow the flesh? People who follow Satan? We're in church, so of course we say, well, of course not. No. How stupid. No. But look at who you look at. Look at who we follow. Look at who we idolize. Look at how we emulate. Look at how we copy people. Who do we copy? Look, if I want to have more money than I have now, should I emulate the habits of a poor dude or a guy who's got more money than I have? Well, duh, right? Doesn't it make sense? If I want to get a better job, should I follow the habits of somebody who doesn't have a job or somebody who has a better job than I have? Duh, right? If somebody's living closer to Jesus than I am, does it make sense to talk to somebody who's a dirty, rotten sinner dog or somebody who loves Jesus and is really trying to live for the Lord? Duh. Hang out with people who love to hang out with him. People will call you names. You won't need the book of Peter to tell you, but just like Peter says, people are going to make fun of you because you don't party with them anymore. Now, if you feel bad that you're missing out on the partying, kind of understandable in the beginning, but after a while, it ought to dawn on you, I'm not missing anything. I don't miss hugging the toilet and throwing my guts up. You had a good time, hijo. Oh, man, that was so good. What did we do? Bring me another smoke. Was that my lung? But I had so much fun. What do I do for a headache? Bring me some more. No, the clear one. No, I don't need the tomato stuff. I just want the... Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Why do I keep slamming my hand in the door again and again? Why do I keep hitting my head against the wall again and again? He's fighting for you. The world says, come on. You're going to get away with it. You're not going to get caught. You're not going to get busted. You're not going to get pregnant. You're not going to get in trouble. You're not going to get hurt. You're not going to get fired. It's okay. Come on. You may not make anything, may not lose anything. but it's okay. The world says, it's okay, come and do it, it's okay. It's not that it's so bad. It's just that it's the world. It's the flesh, it's the devil. And he's waiting for you to vote. Which way do you want to vote? You just vote. Some of us realize to get close to God, you gotta be clean. And that means you start saying no to more stuff. Start saying no. God wants us to recognize that he's different. He's peculiar. And you are a peculiar people. He says, the people who get to come up into my presence will not trust in an idol. They will not swear by a false god. If you still have santos at home, if you still have saints, I don't know what to tell you, you superstitious kook. Or you're worshiping it, and then you're in trouble with God, like for reals. But if you're not worshiping it, you're just like every other Baptist that I've known. Well, yeah, but you know, I got it from my uncle. I'll see, like he was so spiritual, but he left you a santo, so you're going to preserve it and protect. It's plaster of Paris or plastic. It's made of alabaster. I don't care. Break it. No. In fact, I'm going to send it to 7 people so that I won't get bad luck. You know, we don't think like that. We're hung up on superstition. It's one of the that I have with moving from, you know, we're in the desert Southwest. Most people around here are Catholic. They pray a prayer and end up in charismatic churches. One of the main reasons I get so concerned is because there's a lot of superstition in the Catholic Church. There's a lot of superstition in charismatic churches. A lot of touch this, pray this, do this, and that'll work. Oh, see, when are we going to grow up? It doesn't work like that. You don't get the Holy Ghost through my hand. You get cooties and a cold from my hand. I'll hug you. I'll shake your hand. Shoot, I'll kiss you. Not like that. Not like that. But like that. I'll kiss you like that. I'm not really a handshaker. You know, I'm more a fist bumper. I'm more a orale, you know. Not because I'm South Valley Lospa, but because I don't have to touch you if I go like that. I don't mind hugging you. You're not going to get the Holy Spirit like this or like that or like this. Everybody raise your hands up and pray toward our brother. Just stretch your hand out toward our brother. Pray. What the heck is that? That's magic. And if it works, worse. It's magic that worked. You don't get anything by reaching. Let's pray. Let's all put our hand, reach toward the clock and try to make it go back 5 minutes. No, it won't. I already talked too long. You can put your hand out all day long. It's not going to change. But for some reason, we think that spiritual stuff can work through superstition. It's not God stuff. It's just good luck. It's just a rabbit foot. It's just a horseshoe. It's just a santo. Throw it away. Break it and throw it away. Oh, no. Okay, whatever. Don't trust in an idol. Don't swear by a false god. No superstition, no substitution. God will have no other gods before him. Any god. Well, we just call him by a different name. His name is God. His name's not Allah. Allah is a moon god. Allah was a Canaanite moon god. Allah is not just another name for God. No, he's not. He's not. God is the God, this God. He's this God. No substitution. No superstition. If you still have a saint at home, hey, if you have a Virgin Mary, bring it. Lauren will break it. We'll do another. Bring the bathtub, too. If you have one in your backyard, bring the bathtub, too. It's got cooties all over it, too. Why do people get so upset about that? I still have people tell me, when we started the restaurant, I will never go in your restaurant. You're the one who broke the Virgin Mary in your church. You're not going to buy my burrito because I broke a Virgin Mary. And I didn't do it. The woman that God gave me did it. I didn't do it. Man, people are hot. They say, I hate you in your church. You don't have respect. God has no respect for other gods. God has no respect for teaching that's not the truth. But you deal with that. God wants us to enjoy his provision. These guys will receive blessing from the Lord, and they'll receive vindication from the Lord. Blessing from the Lord, that's cool. You know, you listen to Joel Osteen long enough, you want the favor of the Lord. It sounds like, you know, the best parking spot, you know, and not just a good parking spot, but one right in front of the donut place, you know, stuff like that. That's not the favor of God. You know who had the favor of God? John the Baptist. You know who had the favor of God? Isaiah. You know who had the favor of God? Jeremiah. You know who had the favor of God? Jesus. How did it turn out for them on this side? Not so good. How successful was Isaiah, the preacher, or Jeremiah? Man, nothing to show for it on this side. But on God's side, well done, good and faithful servant. The favor of the Lord is not what most of us have been told. The favor of the Lord is going to put you in line for the vindication from the Lord. You know what vindication is? You know what, all you sorry guys, you're all wrong, and he was right. That's vindication. Or, all you guys were wrong, these guys were right. When God vindicates you, when God says, you know all the sacrifices you made? All the stupid stuff you had to put up with because you stood for me instead of going with them? You guys were right. That's vindication. You may not get it on this side. May not see it. May not sense it. May not get it. But you want to be where God is so that when you get there, you hear well done. You want a holy high five from the Lord. If I don't have piety on the inside and I don't have purity on the outside, forget it. My ministry's going to burn up, wood, hay, and stubble. Because I did it for me. I'm a pretty prideful guy. I know that surprises you. I know. The fear of man, ooh, paralyzing. What do people think? What do people think? What do people think? The fear of man, overwhelming. Yeah. God wants us to live beyond that. He wants us to live for him. Now, God's looking out for you. That doesn't mean that he's going to protect you from every bad thing that ever happens. This is an earthquake in Cebu City, Philippines in 2013. Big earthquake. You can see security cameras. People are running outside of the buildings. Security camera from inside of a store. Everybody's running out. The dog makes it out safely. The building's shaking. This is not just, ooh, on a security camera. The building is shaking. The dog got outside safely. Nobody said anything to the dog. The dog sensed something was up. The dog ran back inside. He brought back his buddy. God wants you to bring your buddy out. God wants you to find whoever is in your life who needs Jesus. Bring them out. God wants you to find whoever is in your life who knows Jesus but still isn't living for Jesus. Bring them out. Bring them out. God's looking out for you. He's not going to protect you from every bad thing, but he will preserve you. He will protect you. He will position you from anything, anything in the world. Anything of the flesh, anything the devil can mete out, he'll protect you from that if you vote the other way. What will you vote? Our God is an awesome God, bigger than the governor, bigger than the president, and he still wants you to get to him. So who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands, the one who has a pure heart, the one who is not trusting in an idol, the one who will not swear by a false God. Man, I hope that's you. I hope that's you. I don't want to waste your time. I don't know what God's doing. I don't know what God is doing. I don't know why some things seem to work and some things don't. That's not my concern. My concern is, God, am I moving in your direction? God, am I saying the right things? God, am I doing the right things? Maybe I ought to quit telling you that church isn't magic. Maybe I ought to start telling you it's magical, and if I touch you, you'll get blessed. But you know better than that. Why do we come? Because God said, don't quit coming. Why do we give? Because God says, give. Why do we serve? Because God says, do. God wants us to be involved in a ministry that flows from the heart of God. Fellowship, learning, outreach, worship, and service. A ministry that flows from the heart of God will have fellowship, learning, outreach, worship, and service. That's why, because God wants us to do it. You've never seen this video, but God loves you, and he wants you to love him back. Oh! my heart, and it should break your heart that we don't love Jesus like that. God really loves you. The question is, do you want to love him back? If the answer is yes, Jesus asked, do you love me? He said, keep my commands. Why do you say you love me and then you don't do what I tell you to do? God asks. If you really love God, follow him. God, thank you for loving us first. And thank you that we can love you back. And thank you, God, that no matter what decisions we made yesterday or this morning, this is a new hour. This is a new minute. This is a new chapter in our lives. And Jesus, we want to follow you. It doesn't matter what I got mad about. Doesn't matter what I got crossways about. It doesn't matter how I sinned. It doesn't matter how bad I've messed up. I mean, it matters, and if I need to make things right, help me make things right. But from this moment, Jesus, please help me follow you. With every fiber of my being, help me follow you. Help me say no to sin. Help me say no to the flesh. Help me say no to everything the world is offering. Jesus, help me say yes to you. I love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me first. Thank you for these guys. Thank you, God, that you have called them unto yourself. You've called them to salvation. God, I pray that every single person here will take a good, hard look at their relationship with you. God, I pray that every single one of us, me included, God, that we would take a good, hard look at our relationship with you. Are we really born again? Are we really saved? If we are, Jesus, help us look like it. If we're not, help us recognize it. Please save us. Please change us. Please use us that you might be glorified. These things we pray in your name. Amen. God bless you guys. Go live for the Lord.